it is very hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. It's easier, proverbially speaking, during the times of Jesus, for a camel to enter the eye of a needle. Why? Because it's easy to be proud. You may not say it, and in Singapore, we may not flaunt it, but that's how we think. I'm a self-made man. I'm able to sustain my life. I'm able to live it up. Why would I need God? And why would I even bother with Him? Until God disciplines a man. Sevenfold, 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 sevenfold. Some may be so hardened that they curse God and die. But some may respond to that punishment and turn their hearts around. It is very hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. It's easier, proverbially speaking, during the times of Jesus, for a camel to enter the eye of a needle. Why? Because it's easy to be proud. You may not say it, and in Singapore, we may not flaunt it, but that's how we think. I'm a self-made man. I'm able to sustain my life. I'm able to live it up. Why would I need God? And why would I even bother with Him? Until God disciplines a man. Sevenfold, 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 sevenfold. Some may be so hardened that they curse God and die. But some may respond to that punishment and turn their hearts around.
Good morning. Welcome to Gospel Light Christian Church, our second Sunday service for today. Could I invite all of us who are here in the hall to please arise and look around. Say hi to one another. If you see any new faces, greet them loudly. All right. And for those who are joining us online as well, we welcome you digitally into our cyber church. Come, for those of us who are here, please let us join our hearts together and commit this time to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we want to thank you so much for this beautiful day that we get to enjoy. We thank you for this church, this home, this body of Christ that we get to celebrate and that we get to worship you all together with. Father, we thank you that this life we live is not a solitary one. It is one where we can lean upon one another, where we can build each other up so that, Lord, we may glorify you not only through our words and not only through our work, but through the lives that we live. Lord, we commit this time into your loving hands. We ask that you will soften our hearts and open them so that whatever your word has to teach us, whatever there is for us to receive, that, Lord, we will get, we will receive it gladly, Lord. So we thank you and commit this into your loving hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's consider a portion of scripture together taken from John chapter 1, verses 1 to 5. I'll just read this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. In reverent awe of this mighty, uncreated One, let us sing this song together, God the Uncreated One.
Created One, the author of salvation, wrote the laws of space and time, and fashioned worlds to His design. The One whom angels' hosts revere, hung the stars like chandeliers, numbered every grain of sand, knows the heart of every man. He is King forever. He is King forever. He is King forevermore. Fortress and our strength, the rock on which we can depend. Matchless in His majesty, His power and authority, unshaken by the schemes of man, never changing, great I am. Kingdoms rise and kingdoms fall, He is faithful through it all. Crown Him King forever, crown Him King forever, crown Him King forevermore. Immortal flesh, forsaken by a traitor's kiss, the curse of sin and centuries did pierce the lowly Prince of Peace. Oh, lifted high the sinless man, crucified the spotless Lamb, buried by the sons of men, but He was rescued by the Father's hand to reign as King forever, reign as as King forever, reign as King forevermore. King eternal, God of grace, we crown you with the highest praise. Heaven shout and saints adore. Christ, the King of Kings forever, King of Kings forever, King of Kings forevermore. You're the King of Kings forever, King of Kings forever, King of Kings
of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Our God has many titles, and He is worthy of every one of them. Let us continue to revere and lift up His name. Great is the Lord.
Is the Lord and most worthy of praise. The city of our God, the holy place. The joy of the whole earth. Great is the Lord in whom we have the victory. He aids us against the enemy. We bow down on our knees.
Lord, we want to lift.
And Lord, we want to lift your name on. And Lord, we want to thank you for the works you've done in our lives. And Lord, we trust in your unfailing love. For you alone are God eternal throughout earth and heaven above. The Lord and most worthy of praise. The city of our God, the holy place. The joy of the whole earth. And great is the Lord. The victory. He aids us against the enemy. We bow down on our knees, Lord. And Lord, we want to lift your name on high. And Lord, we want to thank you for the works you've done in our lives. And Lord, we trust in your unfailing love. For you alone are God eternal throughout earth and heaven above. want to lift your name on high. And Lord, we want to thank you for the works you've done in our lives. And Lord, we trust in your unfailing love. For you alone are God eternal, throughout earth and heaven. Eternal throughout earth and heaven above.
The catechism that we will consider this morning is, what are the benefits of believing the gospel? Let us read the response together. The benefits of believing the gospel for the believer are several. His sins are forgiven, and he is reconciled to God. He is justified, declared righteous through the free grace of God in the finished work of Jesus Christ. He is adopted, received into the company of God's children, and having a right to all the honor and privileges that come with being his child. He is redeemed, freed from sin, death, and hell to serve the living God. He is born from above, made a new creation with a new heart that knows and loves God. He receives the Holy Spirit who indwells him and empowers him to live the Christian life. He is made a member in the body of Jesus Christ. He will be raised up in glory at the resurrection. We thank God. Please be seated. We just read the benefits of believing in the gospel. But if you are joining us for the very first time, you might find it curious, because what is the gospel? So here we have it, two verses that very succinctly explain it. John chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. We come now to a time of silent confession. If you're joining us for the first time, silent confession in Gospel Light is a time where we pray and commit unto God our prayers. We thank him for the blessings that he has given us in the week, and we confess our sins and ask for his forgiveness. So let's take this moment of silence to pray together. The scriptures, it is written, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." Our Lord Jesus, you bore our suffering, our shame, our punishment in our stead. You were separated so that we might be reconciled. Unto you, O Lord, alone shall all praise be due. We declare your sacrifice, and we declare your victory. Church, let us sing of the Lord's victory together. Behold the Lamb.
Sins away, slain for us, and we remember the The promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. Of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. And so we share in this bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King. Blood that cleanses every stain of sin, shed for you. Drink and remember, he drained that cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. And so we share in this bread of life, we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of grace around the table of the King. And so with fullness and faith we arise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. And as we share in his suffering, table of the King. As we share in his sufferings, we proclaim Christ will come again and will join in the feast of heaven around the table of the King. Table of the King.
A very good morning to all of you. Welcome to Gospel Light, our second English worship service this Sunday morning. Glad to have you here with us. We'd like to, in particular, welcome our guests and friends joining us for the first time. We'd like to honor your presence and also to pass you a simple welcome pack, so that you may get to know more about this church. So, can I know by a show of hands those who are here with us today for the first time? Just like to know who you are, honor your presence, and pass you a welcome pack. Any first-timers here with us? Thank you for letting us know. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Anyone else? First time here with us? Thank you for letting us know too. Appreciate. And also at this corner, thank you. Anyone at the back? Corners? First-timers with us? Well, if you are new with us, you're shy about letting us know, we would still want to invite you, if you can, to join us downstairs after the service at level one. There are round tables just in front of the lift lobbies. That's where our befrienders are, and that's where we can get in touch with you also. Look forward to catching up with you there. We now come to the time of offerings, and offerings in Gospel Light are free will. That is to say, there is no compulsion to give whatsoever. This is for Christians. We worship the Lord with our finances because He first gave His Son for us, and this is our desire to see the gospel advance. So may the Lord bless each and every cheerful giver. We will also be looking at some announcements on video before we would prepare ourselves to the hearing of the preaching of God's word by Pastor Paul. So God bless.
It begins with openness, the willingness to come alongside someone else, to pour out care, invest. It's about sharing the journey, doing life, together, growing, forging, becoming. To love people as Christ has loved us. It's rejoicing when they rejoice, hurting when they hurt, being a hand, an encourager, a friend. We are not created to wander alone.
Our sermon scripture text for today is taken from Leviticus chapter 1, verses 12 to 13. Let's read this all together. Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of His fierce anger. From on high He sent fire, into my bones He made it descend. He spread a net for my feet. He turned me back. He has left me stunned, faint all the day long.
Morning, everyone. Let's unite our hearts together in a word of prayer. Gracious God, our loving Heavenly Father, thank you so much for gathering us on the special day you have set aside. Thank you, God, for everyone that's here, especially for bringing people who have been maybe unable to come for some time, and even people who have never been here before. Thank you for each one who is here. We pray, dear God, as you look down and you know all our needs, we pray this morning you will meet our needs. We come with very different needs. And yet, God, we know you're not a God who sees us as a congregation. You see us as individuals, everyone, every human made in a very unique way, every piece a masterpiece from the Master. And so, God, we pray you will just guide us accordingly today. Lord, we pray for those who are unable to come. Lord, some are sick, some are actually in hospital at this time. Some are going through treatments that hinder them from coming. And we ask you, God, even wherever they are, may this day, may this time be a time when they could set aside lots of things and lift up their eyes. We pray for those with special needs, that you meet their needs this morning and every day. And we pray for those, Lord, who are grieving. We pray for Pastor Vic, who lost his dear sister, who used to be right here with us, who lost her yesterday to a sudden, possibly heart attack. We pray you be with the Yule family in a special way. Lord, we just come today and we lift up our eyes to you and say, God, speak to us today. Speak to us personally. We don't want to come and hear a generic message. You want to come and hear your message for each of us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Pastor Jason, PJ has gone through a 12-week journey on Leviticus. A very, very amazing, enlightening journey through Leviticus. Now, Leviticus is a difficult book, and many people, well-intentioned Christians, have stumbled many, countless people by telling them, just read through the Bible. So, dutifully, there's a new Christian, you know, eager, will read through Genesis. Oh, that's not bad. It's very interesting. A lot of stories about things you can understand. They read through Exodus. Wow, the great escape. Million people escaping out of Egypt. Wow, that is understandable too. And then the last part of the back part of Exodus, well, getting a bit heavy. By the time they come to Leviticus, I think 90% have surrendered, right? First few chapters, seven chapters about how to kill a lamb. You know, it's like, all right, do I really need to know that? You know, how do you slaughter it, take the blood, spread here, throw the blood there, skin the animal, chop it to pieces. Oh, goodness, what in the world is all this? Some of the more determined ones go a little bit more. They go into the part on the laws, you know, the laws of the cattle drop here. You got a menstrual period, you do this. And, you know, everything looks so confusing. And to be honest, many surrender at Leviticus. But we thank God for Pastor Jason, who led us through a 12-day amazing and enlightening journey through Leviticus. You thought now you know everything about Leviticus. Sorry, we're having another session on Leviticus today. All right? The difference is it won't be deep. You won't need to take out your notes, your pen, put it all aside, sit back, relax. Okay? Now, the analogy is something like this. Pastor Jason, being who he is, a bit more hospitable patient than I am, and a very generous man. If he has a friend coming to Singapore and his friend tells him, hey, PJ, I'm coming to Singapore for 12 days, I am pretty sure PJ would organize for him a nice 12-day trip through Singapore. You know, he probably planned it, just like his sermons, all very well planned. His itinerary probably got the 3 A's and 4 B's too, all right? And so it'd be all planned, his friend would get the itinerary, and for 12 days, he'll go through Singapore and see all the sights. And they'll leave Singapore with a lot of amazing, enlightening facts. They could almost be ambassador for Singapore after the 12-day trip. Now, if I have a friend coming, I think it's going to be a little different, okay? Most of my friends are missionaries passing through. So they often arrive on the morning here. In the evening, they'll leave for, say, wherever, Vientiane, Laos, or Myanmar, whatever. And so what they do is they'll tell, hey, PC, I'm in Singapore for so many hours. Are you there? You know, it's like a nice way to say, can you take us around? And yes, I'm here. And PC, this is my first trip to Singapore. Okay, that's another hook. And then it's our 10th anniversary. Wow, okay. And it's the first time we are in Singapore. Okay, all right. So I'm going to take you around Singapore from morning and get you back to Changi Airport by the evening. All right. So I take them around in a quick one-day trip of Singapore. Not PJ style, PC style. All right. Now, at the end of that one-day trip, most of them will end up with 3 points about Singapore. Firstly, it's very costly. All right? I ask them, why you stay? Your 10th anniversary, why don't you stay longer? Oh, Pastor, the hotel already can die. That's my whole month's support, one-day hotel. All right? Which is true. Hotels are horrendously expensive here. So they don't want to stay in a hotel. Then you take them for their first cup of coffee in a decent cafe, ask them to order their breakfast, they get heart attack already. I thought the coffee is like, wow. And then you say, order your breakfast. Wow, $16.80 for one piece of toast and one egg on it. It's like, no need to have breakfast, all right? So now the impression they have of Singapore is usually very costly. That's one thing they will leave Singapore after that 12-hour journey. And people say, how's Singapore? Expensive, all right? That's the one thing they will say. Of course, when by the time you start to talk about the price of cars, they almost fainted already. And then you tell them the price of house, they died, right? Okay? So, definitely one impression, costly. Second impression, when they do get out of the trauma, they see, wow, Singapore quite nice, huh? Very clean, huh? Very organized, huh? A lot of laws, huh? They heard about chewing gum law, they heard about $500 for, throwing things. All these things they already heard. So they say, wow, your country very, a lot of laws, huh? Yeah. Fine country, right? Fine, yeah. But they like it because it's the laws made the place very nice, very pleasant. So though they hear funny things about our laws, but when they see, it works for us, right? So the second thing they'll say is, wow, Singapore, a lot of laws, but nice, huh? Nice place, clean, efficient. Okay, second thing they'll probably go back with after that 12-hour trip. And the last one is, they'll go back with kind of awe, that, these houses all built by whom? Government. All these kids go to school where? Government school. Everything government? Yeah. And then you sick, where you go? Hospital. Which hospital? Oh, my heart all done in government hospital. Oh, government everything. Oh, very good. How to be citizen? They'll ask you the next thing. All right? Because, wow, this government take care of everything. Yeah? So there's a kind of awe at the end of it all. That, wow, you all good, huh? Your government take care of everything, huh? All right? So these are three things that typically my guests would go back with. Costly, clean, and wow. Okay? So let's look at our first thing that we, as we go through the book of Leviticus. Okay? Now, for many of you, you have gone through Pastor Jason's. You're probably doing your revision, I hope, and probably you forgot 90% of it already, right? And you can revise 50 times, you'll forget 90%. Today, no need to take notes. I think you will remember everything because there are only three things, right? Number one is the costly sacrifice. Now, the first 7 chapters of Leviticus, where we read about how to kill a sheep, how to slit the fallow and the blood come out, take the blood, throw it aside with water. Then after that, not bad, as if that's not bad enough, where innocent lamb is killed, bloody, you are supposed to skin the animal. Or you ever tried skinning an animal? Not, no joke, okay? All right? You say, wow, skinning a cat, it's like, skinning a lamb, no joke. Brutal, no? Go rip off the skin from the meat. Not easy, okay? All right? Don't try, all right? After you rip the skin from the meat, which is already very brutal and looks violent, you're supposed to chop the stupid animal into pieces. Oh, this is even worse. Then all those lumps of meat, you throw on the fire. And the fire is supposed to consume that meat until it's ashes. First 7 chapters, huh? Most of you are like, is it? You didn't read it, right? You didn't read it seriously, right? You read Pastor Jason's notes, right? Because you read it, that's exactly what I am saying. Now, this idea of killing a lamb is not new. The Garden of Eden, when Adam sinned, Adam tried to hide from God. He realized he needed to hide from God, his nakedness before God. He used fig leaves. Didn't work. Don't try using fig leaves to cover your nakedness, all right? Not a good covering. So what did God do? God killed an animal and covered Adam with the skin of the animal. That was the first sacrifice. Poor innocent animal died for Adam and Eve's sin. Then we know Abel brought a lamb. Then we know Abraham had a sacrifice. Then we know Passover, they kill a lamb and put on the door. We know all that. The lamb. We know that. But when it comes to Leviticus, it's not occasional. It's not when in the garden once, Abraham once or twice or three. In the book of Leviticus, it says mandatory minimum every day. You make sure that altar is bloody, fresh blood every day, morning and evening, mandatory minimum. Bring a lamb, cut the lamb, blood comes out, skin it, chop it, throw the meat on the fire, the flames will wipe it to ashes. Mandatory minimum, but the minimum was never the normal. Because in the book of Leviticus, it tells us, when you sin, bring a lamb. When you're thankful, bring a lamb. So many lambs were brought there. In other words, what was occasional became regular. In fact, there's no other religion like that. Have you ever thought about it? What are the major religions in the world? Hinduism? Don't kill, cannot kill, cannot kill. Buddhism, cannot kill, cannot kill. Brutal, you people, kill. Islam, once a year. A few days ago in Singapore, 3,000 sheep were slaughtered. Once a year. But at Leviticus, every day, every single day. Now imagine you lived there. You were a slave. You had escaped, you managed to pull one lamb along with you, cross the Red Sea with your one precious lamb, and then you're told, when you sin, bring that lamb. My one lamb, sacrifice it. Wow! They didn't have herds, they didn't have flocks. And yet that precious lamb, whenever they sinned, they were supposed to bring it to the tabernacle and slaughter it. Wow! So many, many thousands, can I say millions, of lambs were sacrificed at the tabernacle and the various temples, all right, that were built. What's all this about? Why so bloody? In fact, Jews today will not sacrifice animals. Jews today will say, that's barbaric. Jews! They say, we have already advanced. When we're teaching our children killing and violence and blood, that's wrong. In fact, when we talk to other people of every other religion, this sounds brutal and primitive. And that's why we don't preach a lot about it. We want to be educated, sophisticated. But what was God teaching us? God was teaching us that there's only one way. For all of us, ever to solve the problem of sin, which is the cause of the problems of everything in the world. One way, and that is the Lamb. A few weeks ago, I was in church having my lunch, or trying to have my lunch, and a group says, Pastor, can you come for a few minutes? That's very normal, all right? And it was a heated discussion. Pastor, Old Testament, how do people get saved? I said, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me, right? You men, right? I asked this person, it was a lady actually. She said, I woman, yeah. All right? No man, no woman come to the Father but by me. So I said, well, you ask me this question. Old Testament says also, I have to trust Jesus as a Savior. But Pastor, Jesus didn't come yet. How? These are old-time Christians, mind you, and I want you to get this clear. I said, so they didn't see Jesus by their eyeballs because he hadn't come, but they saw him by faith. That God will one day provide a lamb. They said, how come like that? I said, I asked her, you ever saw the lamb? She said, no. Then how you believe? You also by faith believe, right? You look back 2,000 years and you saw a lamb. By what? Faith. So those fellows in the wilderness, they saw by what? Faith. The lamb that was to come. I look back at the lamb that came by faith. Please, gospel writers, I don't want to hear anyone ask this question again. How are we saved? One way. Jesus Christ. Old Testament, they saw him, the coming lamb. New Testament believers like us, we saw him, the came lamb. By faith. Okay? Don't ask me anymore, right? Because that is so fundamental. All the blood of these lambs were to teach us that. All right? So, all this blood teaches us all that endless sacrificing of blood and fire, that the fire was never allowed to be extinguished. Never. The fire in the tabernacle, the temple, was never allowed to be extinguished because it originally, in Exodus, it came, boom, from higher, from heaven down to the altar. That was to be kept burning. All right? So every Jew knew one thing. Bloody sacrifice and a fiery end. Now, if they didn't get the AV message for 1,000 years and more, then I don't know what else God should do. But you know, for most Christians, we don't get it. Okay? For most Christians, when you talk about the suffering of Jesus, they will say this, Jesus died at the hands of the Romans. The Romans flogged him, you know. The Jews spit on him, you know. The Jews beat him, you know. The Romans nailed him, you know. You know how much he suffered for us? And that's true. We have to admit that is suffering. But is that the suffering of Jesus Christ? Is that the totality? Or is that even the little drop of sufferings of Jesus Christ? I'm not minimizing his physical death, but can I say this? His death was much more than that. All right? That's what everybody sees. Jesus hung on the cross for 6 hours, 9 a.m., 3 p.m., roughly. First 3 hours, everybody could see. They saw that. Isaiah 52:14. As many were astonished, his appearance was so marred, disfigured, beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. When you see a lamb being chopped to pieces and you see the meat, do you know it's lamb meat? Can you tell? You can't. It's meat. You can say, marred beyond sheep semblance. Every time they went there and they saw the lamb chopped up and become pieces of meat, what would they say? The meat was beyond lamb or sheep or cattle semblance. Make sense? Because meat is meat. It's bloody. It's ugly. Right? Beyond that of the children of mankind. You know, when you see Mel Gibson, you see sacred pictures of Jesus suffering, some blood trickling down. Does he look like a man? Definitely. That's not a fair representation. That's not what the Bible says. Jesus didn't look like a man on the cross. He was so beaten, he was so marred, you couldn't quite tell. that a man? It's meat. I think it's a man. Well, I hope that's an honest interpretation. So as much as Mel Gibson and the Passion of the Christ and the sacred artists try to draw, they minimize the physical sufferings of Christ. But can I tell you this? The sufferings of Christ were much more than that. Because the Bible tells us, at noontime, 6 hours is a Roman way of saying noontime. Romans start the day at a.m., 6 a.m. 6 hours, noontime, until 3 p.m. Typically, the brightest time of the day. Darkness covered the land. 3 hours, nobody knew what in the world was going on. It's as if God pulled the shutters down. God pulled the curtain down and said, you won't understand this, no need to see. And it's true. We wouldn't understand it. For 3 hours, there was silence. And finally, there was this cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then finally, it is finished! The lights came on. All right? Now, what was happening in these 3 hours? Romans? I think the Romans were trembling during the darkness. Suddenly they were, crucify him, crucify him, and the lights turn off. You know, everybody knows only one can turn off the sun, it's God. All the Roman soldiers, all the Jews, is God angry? They couldn't go anywhere, it was totally dark. They couldn't say a word. They were trembling. For 3 horrendous hours, they stood there quiet. This is a description of the sufferings of the Jews. The temple, Jerusalem was destroyed, and Jeremiah wrote the suffering. But you know, like everything in the Old Testament, it is a type. Many things are types of Christ. When I read this, this is possibly the best explanation of what happened in the 3 hours. Is it nothing to you, all you that passed by? Wow, Jesus suffered. Wow, the Romans, huh? Look and see if there's any sorrow like my sorrow which is brought upon me, which the Lord afflicted me on the day of his fierce anger. Now, if Jesus suffered at the hands of cruel people, I can tell you right now in Gaza, in Palestine, there are many people suffering. Horrible sufferings. Bullied, oppressed. I'm not pro this or pro that, I'm just telling you. There are many people suffering. Slapped, punched, beaten. But that's not. It says, is there any sorrow like my sorrow, which the Romans afflicted me? No! Which the Lord afflicted me. Hey, Pastor, you know, on the Passion, the Romans beat Jesus. No, this is the Lord. Get it? All right? And where did it come from? From on high. On high. Not from the side, the Roman punched me. No, not the nails from, no, from on high. And he's talking about fire, okay? And he's talking about fire in my bones. Can you tie it up to Leviticus? Can anybody tie this up a little bit? If you were a Jew and you went to the temple and your papa brought you to the temple many, many times, and every time what do you see in the temple? Any fancy service like this? No! First thing you see is an altar, fire, bloody. Does it tie up a little bit? When a Jew read this, the fire on the altar had come from heaven and started the first fire, and it was continued. So my friend, when you read that, What is it to you? What happened in the 3 hours? Any Roman slapped him? Anybody nail him further? More nails? More spit? No. Nothing. Until he cries out, "My God, my God." And then he said, "It is finished." Which simply means the penalty is fully paid. In English, it is finished. 3 words. In Greek, 1 word. Tetelestai. Settled. Fully paid. The debt is paid. What debt? Well, I think my debt. Your debt. Because I know there's a place called hell. And it's a place of unquenchable fire. And I know that I deserve to go there. That's why people are terrified of dying. I don't care if they're all alone in the world, there isn't soul left, there isn't anything in their body worth living for, they're in great pain from head to toe, and yet they are terrified of dying. You say, they're frightened of living this world. What are you talking about? They're actually dying to leave the pain, dying to leave the sorrow, dying to leave the frustration of this world. These are people, got, and yet, you know what? They're terrified of dying. Because deep in their heart, they know something else. It's called that. It's called a lake of fire. We deserve that. We're destined for that. Until somebody took our place. We call it a substitutionary atonement. He went and paid the penalty for me, a penalty I could not pay. He willingly paid, and he took my place. If your idea of Jesus' suffering is Roman whips, are you going to be bitten by Romans in your eternity? Are you going to be spat on by Jews? No! But are you going to be in fire? Yes! But who took that fire? Christ. You see, when you see Leviticus and you see a lamb, bloody, don't look like a human, and fire consuming it, does it tie up? Or is it just Leviticus chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3? No, my friend. It's about a costly sacrifice that Christ made. I can't grasp it. I just know this. 2,000 years ago, long before PC was born, this Savior of mine was 100% God, 100% man. He's not a guru, he's not a prophet. He's a Savior because he's the only 100% God, 100% man. As God, he knew me. I wasn't born yet. As God, he knew all my sins, which I have not yet committed for. Another 2,000 years later, he knew me. He's God. He saw every sin of mine. Because as God, he can see the past, present, future as one span. And as God, he saw every sin, he remembered every sin, and every sin was placed on the Savior. And as man, he could suffer because God cannot suffer. And I don't understand how. How the eternal, unquenchable fire of eternity could be concentrated in that 3 hours, poured out on one person. Now, what is the depth of that pain? I will take eternity to grasp. Till then, there was darkness. Nobody can grasp it. But I hope you understand. I hope you understand Jesus' suffering is not... No! Don't sell short the sufferings of Christ. I hope you didn't think the suffering of the Lamb was just chop, chop, chop. Some blood. There was flames to burn and consume the Lamb to ashes. All right? My friends, that was a costly sacrifice. And every time you talk to a Christian, He says, Christ took my suffering. I say, what suffering? The nails. You going to get nails? No. The whipping. You going to be whipped? No. Now what are you talking about? Every substitute must be a fair substitute. If I take your Rolls Royce car, I don't give you back a little scooter. You know that? To say it's fully paid, I pay you a Rolls Royce. To say it is finished, he had to pay for what you and I should have suffered. No cheating, no discount. Fully paid. That's what he said. My friends, if you don't understand the costly sacrifice of Christ, your response will be lame. I'll talk about it in a minute. Let me just briefly say, many people come and tell me, Pastor, I only appreciate my mother after I became a parent. I say, I know. Because before that, you never really appreciated your mom. And even I can tell you this, it pains my heart to hear, where's your mom? Old folks home. Good. Good old folks home, Pastor. Nice one. Very fine. I know you're doing your best. How often you visit your mom? When I'm free. When's the last time you visit? Last week. I say, if you knew what your mom did for you, you understood that, your response would be very different. You see, God has put in the human heart a very funny thing called gratitude. In fact, God put in everybody's heart, even animals. Be kind to animal, generally it's kind to you. Unless you threaten it. When we know someone has done much for us, we tend to do much in return. You know why Christians are so slipshod and so casual with how they serve God? They think it's... Go on YouTube and see what the people suffer there. Big deal. Is that it? Houses are blown up and all that. There's suffering, man. Real suffering. Seeing moms are willing to suffer for their kids in Gaza, or willing to line up and get shot or whatever, because they're kids. Is that all Jesus did for you, dear friends? You see, Jesus just like a good mom, a good dad. My friend, is there any suffering like his suffering? If you don't get it, you don't respond accordingly. All right? So the first thing we must get when you go to the book of Leviticus is not this. It's the costly sacrifice, number two. After we come to the costly sacrifice, the seven chapters or so on the killing of this innocent lamb and the bloody and the fire that never ends, I repeat that, the fire that never ends on that altar. It's never ended, all right? Until the temple was destroyed. Second thing when you read the book of Leviticus is the laws. Help me. So many laws. And worst part, they're all mixed up. I thought God's a God of order. Why are there laws on how to worship? How to behave when you have a menstrual period? It's like, what's that got to do with, man? A law on when your neighbor's sheep drop into the ditch, what you do. And then the next line is about how to worship God. It's like, excuse me, God, can you just put the sacred things in the sacred box and put the mundane things in the mundane box? You're God of order, right? Why is it all mixed up? Did God not know how to write things properly in categories and classifications? You know why it's mixed up? Because we as Christians, we don't have two boxes in our life. We don't have the Sunday box, the sacred box, and the secular weekday box. Are you following me? Well, on Sunday, dress properly, talk properly. When you sit around your CG, pastor come, talk properly, you know? The rest of the week, different. It pains my heart. I tell someone, oh, he's in your office. He's my church member. You know what's the answer? He's a Christian. I didn't know. I said, how long your church? 20 years. Huh? I had no idea he's a Christian. Is that common? Yes. Very common. Because we have a Sunday behavior and a weekday behavior. And so what happens? The Jews were given laws like this to realize sacred and secular, there's no divide. We are ambassadors for Christ. We're children of God. If you're the ambassador of Singapore to some place, you don't just behave in official functions like a decent person. I hope all the time you don't do pickpocket on a Monday, cheat people on a Tuesday, walk around half nude on a Wednesday, you know? Because it's not official, get it? We know who we are and we behave accordingly. You know, the food laws are very funny. I always wonder why the food laws are so many, more than everything else. Because food, you eat 3 times a day. And every time you eat, you have to think, as a Jew. Chew the cud, divide the hoof. Does it? This seafood, this water being, got scales, got fins. You have to ask. You know, about trouble about food is 3 times a day you have to think. Your periods once a month. Whether your house got fungus on the wall, maybe never. Maybe your neighbor's sheep drop in a ditch, maybe never. But eating 3 times a day, you have to ask yourself, am I doing right? Is this the best way, the best food to eat? Are you following me? What is God trying to teach the Jews? One, you should be visible to people that you're different. That's number one. Number two, you should be thinking all the time, just as you eat. Will this please God or not? So you see, the food laws are there, not for no good reason. They jumble up not for no good reason, for a very good reason. All right? So, in Israel, when you pass motion, you cover the thing. When you want to do this, with your no, nothing, don't mess up your neighbor's cattle. Everything was orderly and proper. There were laws to make things good, to make the Israelites look different from the messy neighbors they had. All right? So, we must know the costly sacrifice, and we must also know Leviticus is about laws that lead us to live a little differently and live in a way as best we know how to please God and men. All right? And then the third one. So we got lambs, we got laws, the third one is light. Have you ever thought about it? They have no entertainment there. They got nothing there. 2 to 3 million people live around one thing. The tabernacle and the, what was the highlight of the tabernacle? It was not architecture. It was its lighting. This tube from heaven seemed to come down. Light. Providing light for 2 to 3 million people. And you know, because of this tube from heaven, these 2 to 3 million people didn't need to work. They just come out of slavery. They work like a dog just to have a decent meal. Or just to have a meal. And now they do nothing, and every day, this light, this God, who is from heaven, drops food for us. And food for our cattle. Wow. And provides water for us. And this God provides light for us at night. And this God leads us when we are going through the wilderness. When it lifts up, it goes, we follow. And this God protects us. Nobody has attacked us. We don't have a fortress. We don't live in a beautiful high wall surrounding. We're little tents, helpless people. And yet, we are protected, we are provided, we are guided. by this. You see, in Egypt, there was a god for everything. There's a god for the water. There's a god for the cattle. There's a god for fertility. Whatever. But here, no. One God. Every day. This one God gave them all they needed. Okay? So, what's the book of Leviticus? If you did a quick ride to the book of Leviticus, what would you see? Costly sacrifices. Lots of laws that made them different and pleasing to God and one another. How they lived. And they live in constant awe of this being, this God. All right? So that's a quick tour of Leviticus. Now, the hard part is, what's your response? What's your response to all this? Right? If you know how much Christ sacrificed for you, you'll respond accordingly. If you think he's suffered like a mother in Palestine now, well, you'll respond accordingly. Beaten by oppressors, rejected by people. That's fine. Many have been suffering. Many mothers have suffered more for their kids. But if you know what Jesus suffered for you, what would your response be? Costly sacrifice? Costly service? Not Christian hobby. Let me explain. Most people here serve God like a hobby. I'm sorry to say that. They do it in their free time. They do it in something they are happy to do, pleased to do, good at. They do it because it makes some people happy. Let me give you an example. There are plenty of unbelievers have hobbies. Baking is a popular one. Now I got more time. I work from home. So you know what I do? I bake. What you bake? I like baking lah. Then what you do with the cookies? I give my friends lah. They're happy. I'm happy. We all have a nice time. So we call that a hobby. Many people have this. Art, cooking, baking, walking dog, whatever. And then in the church, a bit more spiritual. Why you do this? This ministry. Yeah, my free time leh. I can make it on time. Why you do this? Yeah, I like kids. Oh, I see. Why you do this? Kids like me. What? Oh, I see. So that's called Christian service, huh? I thought that's called hobby. Sorry, huh, to spoil a lot of people here. You see, a costly sacrifice demands a costly service. It's like your mother. If you know how much your mother suffered and worked hard and missed hundreds of meals for you and hundreds of nights of sleep and then took care of you, you grasp it, which most kids don't grasp. You won't visit your mother when you're free because you knew your mother when she was not free. Made time for you. Lost sleep for you. Ayah, Pastor, I'm very tired. No, I don't have much time to visit her. No, when I got free time, I go and see her. Oh, okay. Well, is that serving your mom? Well, for some people, their conscience says, yes, so be it. And that's the majority. That's the majority. They go when they're free. Go there, say a few things, buy a few things. See you, Mom. Next week, come back. You've got something on? Sorry, Mom, I couldn't make it last week. No costly sacrifice? No understanding of it? No costly service? casual service. Response to Leviticus today. Response to Leviticus to a costly sacrifice is costly service. I hope somewhere, somehow, we like animals, beings, we have gratitude. Number two, clean living. How are you going to make a difference? How are you going to make a difference to people? You got one short life here. For many Christians, you know what you're going to do with this life? See the world before it's too late. Wake up, man! If you are a saved man, you will see the world. Revelation 20 tells us that you will be in the new heaven and new earth. I will be seeing the world with you. We can go hiking together. We can climb Mount Everest together. We can do 1,000 things together in new heaven. I'm not going to float on a stupid cloud forever, man, and sing hallelujahs. No! I'm saved to dwell in a new heaven and new earth. Yes, intermediate. While before Christ's second coming, I wait for him on a cloud. That's called waiting room. You go to the airport, there are waiting rooms. That's not your destination. The cloud is your waiting room, buddy. But you know what Christians do? They want to see their bucket list first. I say, why are you going to hell? I say, no, Pastor, I believe I'm safe. Then, what's your list then? Do the things you cannot do there, now, here. As far as I can remember, two things I can't do there. I can't share the gospel there because everybody up there with me is saved. I can't disciple them. And I got to do it here. Everything else I can do there except sin. Climb mountains, canoe down rivers, explore planets, the new heaven and new earth, I'll be there. But evangelize to one guy, no. Ends. I do it now. Are you going to do it? But how can you do it when you don't, when your life is not even attractive? When people in the office don't even know you're a believer? You know how difficult it is to get someone to hear the gospel when they don't even know you're a believer? You try to share the gospel, they look at you like, whoa, why are you so religious today? And many people want to share the gospel. They can't. They don't have a starting point. Their life is not right. There have been many messed up lives. Clean living, brother. They say, Pastor, I try, but I don't have the courage. I talk to people, they don't listen. Well, let me tell you this. It's not about you. It's about Christ, Holy Spirit lives in you. That fire told them, God is with you. Don't be afraid. Why are you afraid? The God of heaven is right here with you. Christian, why do we say we can't when Holy Spirit lives in us? Why do we say we can't when Christ is in you? Now this is all in Leviticus, graphically shown, costly sacrifice. Live in a way that people can say you're different, you're God's people. Your life is different, your family's different, your kids are happier, your home is less quarrelsome, you're less miserable, you're less grumbly. Your life is different, they will listen. And if they won't listen, you have the power of the Holy Spirit in you to make a difference. You have a message. There's a fire waiting for your relatives who are not saved. Let me tell you that. Your friends, even your worst enemy, you don't want him there. What are you doing about it? Do you believe the fire? Well, in Leviticus, they saw it. Well, this is the short journey through Leviticus. No big, brand new things you're going to learn. It's just three simple things. Costly sacrifice demands a costly response. Service. A costly service won't get you anywhere till you have a clean, differentiated life. And without the power of the Holy Spirit to help you, you won't do much. It's all in Leviticus. It's all there, graphically staring us, slapping us in the face. The fire, the laws, the lamb, the laws, the light. It's all there. May God help us. May we respond today, not by knowing more about Leviticus, but by doing more about whatever little you know. God help us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time. We journeyed through Leviticus for 12 weeks. Today is our 13th. May we not keep journeying, ever learning, and never coming to anything useful. Lord, help us. We're not here for a lecture room to write a paper. We're here, Lord, to live a Christ-like life. Lord, there's fire. There's real fire. There's eternal, unquenchable fire. And Lord, it'll consume our loved ones, our friends, and the world around us. We believe it, Lord. Help us to live lives that are clean. Help us to live lives that are empowered by the Holy Spirit. Help us to make a difference. We need you, God. We don't want to go through Leviticus and say another book completed, another book ticked. But Lord, we want to see our life changed. We need you, God. Help us. For those who are not believers, there is a fire. I don't need to tell you. There's a God. I don't need to tell you. Deep in your heart, you know this world didn't happen by chance. You know men, unlike cattle and sheep, don't just die and become barbecue. There's something more. There's something lasting. There's something eternal about a man. And we know there's either a place that place prepared for those that believe and know the Creator and His provision, and a place for those who reject their Creator. And we pray, God, today everyone will know there is one way, Jesus, the one who paid the penalty, heavy penalty for our sins, and said, fully paid. Thank you, Lord. Bless everyone that's in this room. Bless newcomers today. And enjoy the fellowship, the friendship of this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Could I invite the congregation to please arise? We thank God for the preaching of His Word, and we thank God for the reminder of the great sacrifice that was upon the cross. Let us sing in response the very first verse of this song, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches gain I count but loss and poor content.
Father, thank you again for loving us and giving your Son to die and pay for our sins. It's a pain and suffering we will never ever be able to understand nor imagine. We pray therefore this day that you will open the eyes of those who need to believe, and you warm the hearts of those who do, that we will live our lives for your glory. May our worship flow into our everyday lives, and may more come to know the Lord Jesus Christ through us. So thank you for this day of worship. Dismiss us now with your blessings. We ask and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll see you again next Sunday. God bless and have a wonderful weekend.